heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. And I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. Lord, you are perfect in all of your ways to us. Yes, you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. Lord, you are perfect in all of your ways to us. It's love so undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think. As you call me deeper still, as you call me deeper still, as you call me deeper still into love, love, love. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. Who I am. You're a good, you are perfect in all of your ways. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I love you. You are perfect in all of your ways. It's who I am. It's who I am. Shield about me, you're my glory, you're the lifter of my head. Thou, O Lord, art a shield about me. Hallelujah.
Happy New Year, one and all. My hopes and prayers are that this new year, God will bring you and your family, the church, and our country many marvelous blessings and breakthroughs, and that above all, He would be exalted and glorified in this world in 2021. May this be a year where we seek God with all of our hearts and with a renewed sense of purpose to live out the gospel through our words and actions. The title of this morning's message is The Shield of Faith. We've entered into this new year right in the middle of a series on spiritual warfare, where we've been focusing on Paul's letter to the Ephesians, and especially chapter 6, where he talks about the armor of God. And that armor includes, you'll see a graphic up here with a soldier fully suited, and it includes truth, which has been identified as the soldier's belt, righteousness, which is his breastplate, the gospel of peace, which is his shoes, faith, his shield, salvation, his helmet, the word of God, his sword, and then Paul suggests that all this armor is undergirded by prayer. So I think a soldier would be kind of foolish and vulnerable to the enemy's attacks to try to go into battle, leaving just one of those pieces behind. Paul wants us to understand that it's no different for the Christian engaged in the spiritual warfare, and why he urges us in the passage that we've been focusing on to put on the full armor of God. Over the last several messages, we focused each week on one piece of armor at a time. The first three pieces mentioned in verses 14 and 15 are, stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. So we're going to move on in his text, and we're going to, over the next 4 weeks of January, we're going to focus on each of the remaining pieces of armor. Today, the shield of faith. Next week, the helmet of salvation. January 17th, the sword of the Spirit. And then finally, the series is going to culminate and conclude on the 24th, where we're going to focus on prayer, which Paul indicates undergirds all the spiritual armor that we're to wear. So let's go ahead and return to our text, and let's read verse 16. Paul says, in addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. And I want you to notice how Paul changes the verb here. Where the first three pieces of armor had to do with having something, something that you have and put on and that you never take off. Truth, righteousness, and peace are part of and supposed to be, become part of who we are. Now for the final three pieces of armor, Paul switches the verb to have to take up. He switches it from to have to take up. Armor that you pick up and use on that occasion when the day of evil invades your life. Those times when the devil attacks you. He says, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. So at the time Paul wrote to the Christians in the Ephesians church, there were two kinds of shields that the Romans would use. One was small and round, it was handheld, and it was like the ones you'd see in the movies that you'd watch about the ancient gladiators. This is not the one Paul's referring to. The shield he's referring to in is the metaphor he's using in this letter is a shield that was 4 feet high and 2 feet wide. It had hooks on the side so it could link to other shields in a line so that an entire row of soldiers could advance together without being vulnerable to incoming arrows. I just love this picture because it once again confirms that you can't make it as a Lone Ranger Christian. When you go it alone, apart from Christian community, you're extra vulnerable to being struck and taken down by a flaming arrow of the devil. Common back then for enemies was to dip their arrows in pitch and light them on fire. And they'd shoot hundreds, if not thousands, of those flaming arrows at their opponents. Romans would make their shields with iron, and then they'd cover it with two layers of wood. And then they'd wrap that wood in linen, and they would cover that with animal hides, and then they would soak that in water, so that a flaming arrow could be quickly extinguished. Legend has it that one Roman soldier was said to have returned from battle with 200 once fiery arrows still stuck in his shield. I would say probably without realizing it over the years, you may have had anywhere from hundreds to thousands of flaming arrows shot at you by the devil's spiritual forces of evil. It is only your shield of faith that can overcome those flaming arrows that he wants to shoot at you. In 1 John 5:4, John says, "For everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith." So faith in the context of what Paul is speaking of here, what John's writing about, is absolute confidence in God. First of all, in his unchanging character. Hebrews 13, 5 and 6, the writer says, "God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. So we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me?" And then if you go on in that same chapter in verse 8, he says, "Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever." And that is so important to know. That God is not like human beings who change upon a whim or maybe reject you if you don't live up to their standards. The scriptures declare that God never changes. He doesn't need to develop or grow in wisdom, knowledge, power, love, or holiness. He is perfect and complete from beginning to end. His love is always unlimited, unending, and unconditional for those in Christ. His heart always has been and always will be good towards you. His acceptance and approval of you, it's never based on your performance, for your adoption into his family is secure in Christ. Because it's based on what Christ did for you, something that you could never in a million years do for yourself. His faith that Paul White writes of, the shield of faith, it's a trust, it's reliance, it's dependence, it's a belief that's based on this unchanging character of God. It's based on the unchanging word of God, on the unfailing promises of God, on the unlimited power of God, and it's based on God's sovereign rule and reign in the world and over your life. It's a belief that God is who he says he is, that in Christ I am who God says I am, special, precious, his beloved child, and that God will do what he says he will do. It's a faith rooted in the objective reality of the gospel, our saving faith in Christ, our secure standing with God. The kind of faith Paul refers to as our shield of faith is our present trust in Jesus for victory over temptations and trials that the devil wants to use against us in the day of evil. It's a faith that ensures that we will stand and we will remain unmoved. So Paul talks about these flaming arrows of an evil one. And what are these arrows that Paul's speaking about? Well, if you remember earlier in our text, Paul originally spoke of the schemes of the devil so that we can take our stand against the devil's schemes, his strategies to bring us down. And we talked about how it's not a relentless day in and day out attack by the devil. But he kind of sits back and his forces sit back and they observe and they wait for when you may be most vulnerable to attack, which he's referring to of the day of evil in your life. Those times when you are lonely, or fatigued, or sick. Times when maybe you're discouraged or disappointed. Maybe you're going through financial struggles, or you have some unresolved conflict with your spouse or another family member or friend. Maybe it's a time when you've experienced a major loss. You've lost a loved one, or maybe it's a loss of a dream or a goal or a desire. It's in these times that demonic forces attempt to inspire doubt in God, to disguise evil for good, and to deceive you to seek solutions to life struggles and challenges and trials through wrong, sinful choices of disobedience rather than to trust and depend on God. James reveals some interesting things about trials and temptations. I want you to go ahead and turn in your Bible to James chapter 1, and we're going to read verses 2 through 8. James chapter 1, starting in verse 2. He says, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds." There's many kinds of trials, there's many varieties, and there's many degrees that we face through life. There's many kinds. He says, "Because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. If any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. But when he asks, he must believe and not doubt, because he who doubts is like a wave of the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. That man should not think he will receive anything from the Lord. He's a double-minded man, unstable in all he does. So what the devil wants to do in the midst of these trials is he wants to use them to sow seeds of doubt, to produce instability in your Christian walk, to see your faith and trust in God diminish by doubting his love and goodness towards you. Trials are used to get you to doubt God, to test your faith, and the enemy's schemes are devised to get you to fail that test, and through your failure to wreak havoc in your life. James says that what God wants to produce in your life through your trials are a strong and persevering faith, to produce spiritual growth and maturity, a strength to be able to stand firm by faith when in the storms of life. In Romans chapter 5, verses 3 through 5, Paul says it like this. He says that this suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance produces Christ-like character. It's the fruit of the Spirit. It's love, joy. It's what we talked about last time, the peace that comes inside out rather than outside in. And that this Christ-like character leads to hope in our life, a hope that does not disappoint us. You see, because searching for solutions to your problem outside of God's boundaries is always going to lead to disappointment, discouragement, and result in hopelessness. Let's go ahead and read some more in James, verses 13 through 16, chapter 1. James says, when tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. But God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when by his own evil desire he is dragged away and enticed. Then after desire is conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. And what James has outlined here is it's a pattern where we have these many compromises in our life, and we're drawn in, we're enticed to sin, and we give in, and then that sin becomes a stronghold in our heart or in our life, and it always is going to lead to death. The enemy's temptations of sin are designed to get us to shift our focus from God onto someone or something else. If the enemy can get us to be afraid or stuck in worry, to feel guilty or condemned, to get discouraged or lose heart or lose hope due to our circumstances, he can get us to turn to the pleasures of sin as a way out of our trials, as a source of relief or comfort from our pain. Satan's goal is to produce death, to kill any reflection of God's love or goodness or blessings in your life. The author of the book of Hebrews, many believe to be Paul, gives us some great insights from the lives of many of the Old Testament men and women of faith who have gone before us. So turn back a chapter to Hebrews, and let's read verse 1 in chapter 12. He says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. And so what the writer is saying here, he's not saying that as we live our life, all these witnesses who have gone before us and now are in heaven are kind of like in a spectator's gallery watching us live life and cheering us or encouraging us on. What he's saying is that they're witnesses because their lives have testified to this very faith that Paul speaks of, a faith that perseveres through great challenges and struggles and trials in life. When he speaks about these witnesses, who is he speaking of? He's speaking of those Old Testament saints. You know, and he's writing to Jews here, and the Jews who had access to the Old Testament would have known all these stories of these great men and women who lived by faith and what they experienced and what they went through. Often chapter 11, preceding chapter 12 is called the Hall of Faith because the writer outlines all of these stories about these great men and women of faith. And he begins in chapter 11, if you want to turn over there. In verse 1, he says, now faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. So he says the foundation of our faith is not based on what we can see or what we can hold in our hands. It's not based on our senses, what we can see, hear, smell, taste, or touch. That's not what we base our faith in. And then he goes on, and in verse 3, he begins by pointing to our faith that God created everything. And none of us were present to see that. You weren't there. I wasn't there. But we didn't witness it, and yet we believe that God created everything, that he spoke everything into existence from nothing. And then in verse 6, he speaks about a belief that we have in a reality of an unseen God. I've never seen him personally. You've never seen him, and yet we believe in this God. And he goes on and begins to talk about many of these Old Testament heroes of the faith. And in verse 7, he speaks of Noah. And you know, Noah never saw a drop of rain in his life. And yet obeyed God. He crafted an ark that took decades to build, believing God was true to his word, that a worldwide flood was coming, and he would save him and his family through the ark. And so he went on year after year building this ark by faith, believing in God's word and what he had said. Verse 8 talks about Abraham, where he was told by God to leave his homeland, his friends, and extended family, to go to a place he'd never been, that God would reveal to him once he arrived. Abraham obeyed by faith, for he was believing, it says, in a heavenly city that awaited all who believe. And then in verse 11, it talks more about Abraham, that even though he and his wife were way past childbearing age, and Sarah was, up to that point, had been barren, and he believed that God would bless them with a son, the one who would create a family line from whom the future Messiah would be born, in whom all nations would be blessed. And why? It says, because he considered him faithful who had made the promise. In chapter 11, let's go ahead and read verses 24 through 27. This is about Moses. And it says, by faith, Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a short time. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than the treasures of Egypt, because he was looking ahead to his reward. By faith, he left Egypt, not fearing the king's anger. He persevered because he saw him who is invisible. Moses, who had all the pleasures and riches and treasures and status and that he could have possibly had in Pharaoh's family, left that because he believed in the God who was unseen. He believed in the reward for those who believed. He believed that God had a different purpose, and that was to live for him. And then let's go ahead and read chapter 11, verses 36 through 40. Speaking about all of these people in the Hall of Faith, it says some faced jeers and flogging, while still others were chained and put in prison. They were stoned, they were sawed in two, they were put to death by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains and in caves and holes in the ground. These were commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised. God had planned something better for us, that only together with us would they be made perfect. So he lists all of the various different kinds of trials and things that these people of faith, and yet they persevered because they had a faith in an unseen God. They had a belief in the character of the God that they had come to know. They believed in his word and his promises, that no matter what they experienced in this life, there was something greater that was awaiting them in heaven, treasures and rewards and an eternity with God. And so they continued to press on no matter what they faced. And this is the shield of faith that Paul's speaking of. Well, who is the greatest overcomer this world has ever seen? Who demonstrated an unwavering faith and resolution of will to obey God in all circumstances, through great trial and suffering, no matter what the personal cost was to him. Well, the writer in Hebrews 12, 2 through 3 says this. He says, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Remember him who had such struggles against sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. You see, when we talk about taking up the shield of faith, faith is not the focus. Paul isn't speaking of having faith in our faith. He's speaking of Jesus and his redemptive work to be the focus of our faith, and the reason why we refuse to doubt God's love and goodness in the midst of trials. Faith believes Paul's words found in Romans 8, where it says, if God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not, along with him, graciously give us all things? And Paul's saying here, and saying in Hebrews, and says in Romans, that he's saying, fix your eyes on Jesus, because if God was willing to go to that length, to give fully that costly of a sacrifice, to come and pay for your sins in your place, take the punishment that you deserve, then how can you doubt him for any of the other things that you're looking for his promises or his word to come through in your life? If you want to know exactly how Satan tries to undermine your faith, Genesis 3 and Matthew 4, 1 through 11 are great places to start. For in these classic examples, you'll see a pattern. And it often begins with Satan trying to disguise something. It says in 2 Corinthians, I think chapter 12, that he masquerades as an angel of light. And then he tries to sow seeds of doubt. And then he tries to deceive, to abandon God and to choose sin and the life of sin instead. So in that, I wanted to read a couple of excerpts from Chip Ingram's book, The Invisible War, because I thought he said it really well. If you remember, Genesis 3 is talking about the serpent's temptation of Eve, and then Matthew 4 talks about Jesus' temptation of the wilderness. And Chip writes, study these classic examples of the enemy's methodology carefully, and you'll see a pattern that often begins with a disguise. You don't know where the deception comes from, but somehow it casts doubt either on God and his word or you and your worthiness. Both with Eve and with Jesus, Satan began by suggesting that the verdict is still out on God's truth. Has God said, you shall not eat from any tree of the garden? Asked the serpent in Genesis 3:1. If you are the Son of God, he said to Jesus in the wilderness. He does the same with us. Is that really what God meant by that promise? How could a good God have let that happen? Satan doesn't really care how he gets us there, but he wants us to think that God is cruel, indifferent, harsh, unloving, at least towards us, or a stern taskmaster. The first step is to question God's identity as we understand it. Satan's second step is to cause us to focus on our own identity or worth. For he said, you will be like God, knowing good from evil, he told Eve. He promised all the kingdoms of the world to Jesus in exchange for his worship. He fills us with pride over our own rights and identity, or he fills us with questions of our worthiness. You call yourself a mother? You think you're a real man? You're terrible. You have no business pretending you're a Christian. As long as he can get us to think inaccurately about God, ourselves, or others, he can take us down a dangerous trail. Having created a window of opportunity, Satan then offers an appealing, immediate alternative rooted in the three broad sins outlined in 1 John 2, 15 through 16. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. I believe every temptation in Scripture falls into one of those categories. The flaming missiles will exploit or appeal to your flesh, your eyes, or your ego. If his questions have made us vulnerable through doubt, he's found an opening in the shield of faith, and he'll aim right for it in one of those three areas. So I guess the question that we need to answer this morning is, how can we strengthen our faith for battle? How can I strengthen my faith to the point where I have an effective shield to block the flaming arrows of the evil one when the day of evil comes knocking on my door? How can my faith remain strong when I'm attacked by my enemy? And first of all, you have to acquire a trust in God's unchanging character. It means learning and believing from the scriptures that God always has your best in mind. Psalm 84:11 says, "For the Lord is a sun and shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor. No good thing does he withhold from those whose walk is blameless. O Lord Almighty, blessed is the person who trusts in you." And then in Romans 8:32, we talk about this. Paul says, "He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not, along with him, graciously give us all things?" And you know, the root word of goodness, which is so often used to describe God and his character and his nature, it's the very word that means generosity. And as I said earlier, that has been proven through the gift of Jesus. A.W. Tozer says, "God takes holy pleasure in the happiness of his children. He wells up with joy when good things happen in your life, and Satan's flaming arrows are designed to sow doubt in your mind and your heart." Secondly, you must acquire a trust in God's unfailing promises. 2 Corinthians 1:20 to 22 says, "For no matter how many promises God has made, they are yes in Christ. And so through him, the amen is spoken by us to the glory of God." And that word amen means so be it. So we look in the scriptures and we see a promise of God and we say, God said that they're yes because we're in Christ. And so we say, amen, so be it. I believe it. God said it. So I believe it's true. He goes on and says, "Now it is God who makes both us and you stand firm in Christ. He anointed us, set a seal of ownership on us, and put his spirit in our hearts as a deposit, guaranteeing what is to come." So he begins to even illuminate some of those promises that were made, that were fulfilled in Christ. That his ownership, his seal of ownership's on us, that he's given us his spirit in our hearts as a deposit, guaranteeing what's to come. It's like a down payment guaranteeing our future with him forever. Philippians 4:19 says, "My God shall meet all your needs according to his riches, his glorious riches in Christ Jesus." And I think this verse, we like to claim, but it's vitally important to understand that there's a difference between your needs and your wants. It says, "My God shall supply all my needs." He'll supply all your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. 2 Peter 1:3 says that his divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness. And so I see that broken down into two aspects. And that life, I kind of see it as survival, that God has provided air to breathe and food and water and clothing and shelter, an ability to earn money, access to medical care, human need for friendship, the basic necessities of life. In Psalm 37, the psalmist writes, "I've never seen the children of the righteous begging for bread." That's because my God promises that you shall supply all my needs and all of your needs as children of his. And then he says he'll provide everything you need for godliness. And I see that as resources to have a relationship with God, to live the Christian life, to grow and mature, to be fruitful and victorious in spiritual warfare. I've given you everything you need for life and godliness. So what is it beyond these needs that Satan has led you to believe that you're entitled to? What lies are you believing? What things have you wanted and not gotten that have led you to doubt God's goodness towards you? I've led to feelings of discouragement and hopelessness, led you to seek fulfillment outside of the will of God. You see, when you do that, your shield is down. And you've been getting struck over and over by the flaming arrows of your enemy. Satan's deception is to get you to believe that things beyond what you need have been promised by God, and he is letting you down by not providing them. In Numbers 23:19, it says, "God is not a man that he should lie, nor a son of man that he should change his mind. Does he speak and then not act? Does he promise and not fulfill?" So to close this morning, Let me give you three suggestions of application, and I want you to write these down. Is Satan coming after you with seeds of doubt? And first of all, I encourage you to review your past and search for the many times God has been faithful to his promises in your life. I remember doing this one time when Lisa was down and discouraged, and I sat down and I just wanted to allude, you know, over 31 years together, the way that God had broken through and miraculously provided for us. And so I got on my laptop here and I started typing out some things that I remembered from trying to start early on in our lives. And when it was all said and done, I had 7 pages of things where God, I remembered that he broke through in wonderful, miraculous ways, provide for what we needed. Not necessarily what we wanted, but what we needed. And you see, what happens there is that you get a chance to experience God. Jehovah Jireh, the Lord who provides. Jehovah Rapha, the Lord who heals. God, my comforter in times of loss or pain. God who guides me with wisdom and guidance when I'm making important decisions in life. And that's how God wants us to experience him in relationship, is to trust him for these things. And as we wait and as we see him break through, then all of a sudden we get to know him in a way that we haven't known him before. So review your past on how God has provided. Secondly, review your present. List all the current blessings of God in your life that you have reason to be thankful for. You know, so often we're the kind of people where we're like the Israelites in the wilderness who forgot about all the miraculous things God did to rescue them and save them and deliver them and actually provide for them in times of wilderness. And all they could focus on were the things that they didn't have. And that's like how we are. It's like we have this list of all these wonderful things to be thankful for and to not take for granted his blessings. But yet, when something goes wrong, we want to focus just on that and forget about all the things that we have from God in the moment. So review your past and also review your present. And finally, review the Word of God. Begin to memorize verses that you can bring to mind when Satan tries to sow these seeds of doubt. I've given you a number of verses just in this message. But you can go to your concordance and you can look up a certain word that is an area of struggle or doubt, and you can see all kinds of scriptures. Begin to focus on them and meditate on them and memorize them and take them to heart and fill up your mind so that when Satan wants to come after you with seeds of doubt, you have a scripture to reply, just like Jesus did in the wilderness when he actually used Deuteronomy, passages in Deuteronomy 3 times to tell Satan, you're a liar and I'm not believing your lies. You need to remember that Jesus says, knowing the truth will set you free. And finally, this morning, you need to trust in God's sovereign program and timing. Jeremiah 29:11, I know this is one of the favorite verses of my wife, Lisa. She quotes it a lot, but says, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for welfare and not calamity, to give you a future and a hope. Listen, you and I both know, we've been Christians long enough, that God's ways are not always easiest, but they always will prove best. Flaming arrows of doubt and deception must be immediately met by faith, not by your emotions in the moment. Your feelings, they're fickle. They're going to run up and down. They're going to run hot and cold. There are going to be times where your feelings are passionate and then indifferent. It's always depending on your circumstances. But when you believe in a good and loving God who does not change, in his word and promises that do not fail, and a belief that his timing is always perfect, you then have a shield of faith that will help you overcome every flaming arrow shot your way by the enemy. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we lift our praise to you, we worship you, we exalt your holy name, for you alone are God, and we are so thankful, Lord, that you are in our lives, that you revealed yourself to us, that we can come to know you more deeply through your word, and help us to be men and women of the word, that we dive in and we look at the truth of the scriptures, and we get to understand your character and your nature, and then begin to to believe it in our heart of hearts, that that is truly who you say you are, no matter what life says or the world says or circumstances say or other people say, that we can rest and trust in the fact that you are unchanging. You're the same yesterday, today, forever, and you're always loving and good. Lord, help us to sow those words in our minds and in our hearts so that when the day of evil comes and when Satan comes knocking on our door to sow seeds of doubt or to discourage, Lord, that we can recall your word, or we can recall the times in our past when you have miraculously provided, and we can remember all the things to be thankful for in our present, to know that Satan is just a liar. And there's no truth at all in what he says and how he's trying to discourage and deceive and to bring us down. Help us to raise that shield of faith so that we might stand strong in the midst of the spiritual battle that rages around our lives and in our world. And we pray this in your most holy and precious name. Amen.